By the time that you leave today, you're going to know four things. Number one, you'll know what a toxic person looks like, as if you don't know already. But I'm going to present empirical research on what this toxic personality looks like. And by the way, in the research, the term toxic personality is sometimes used interchangeably with the term high conflict personality, for reasons that I'll share with you in just a couple of minutes. So you'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt by the time that you leave here today whether you're working with or living with a toxic individual. Number two, I don't recommend, if you're having issues with a toxic person, that you sit down with them and say, you know, you're like totally toxic, and I'm like totally done with you unless you change your behavior. That's not gonna go well if you approach it that way, because the toxic individual is going to perceive that as an attack. They're gonna perceive that as shaming and embarrassing. So what I'm going to encourage you to do, if you choose to confront this individual, I'm going to encourage you to focus on problematic behavior. What are the behaviors that they're engaging in that make them toxic and that are creating pain, discomfort, and stress for you? So the second goal of today's program is to identify the specific behaviors that add up to a toxic personality. For example, one thing that I see with toxic people is that they have profound problems with anger management. And so we're going to take a look at that and why that is the case. More specifically, they tend to err in the direction of being too aggressive or too passive aggressive. More about that later. The third objective is to enhance your empathy and compassion for people who have the toxic personality. And to that end, I'm going to spend some time with you talking about what produces this personality. For the most part, people are not born toxic. The notable exception to that maybe would be the Kardashian family. But apart from that, most of us who develop toxic behaviors develop those behaviors after we're born. There are certain factors that come together that kind of produce the perfect storm, which we call the toxic personality. And the research indicates that there are three primary factors that need to be addressed in treatment if the person comes into treatment. One, they typically come from pretty profoundly dysfunctional family backgrounds. So we're going to take a look at what a dysfunctional family looks like. And oh, by the way, every family is dysfunctional to a lesser or greater degree. Number two, we know that people who have toxic personalities typically have atypical brain chemistry. Now, in some rare cases, they inherit that atypical brain chemistry, but more often than not, they acquire atypical brain chemistry as a result of physical or emotional trauma. So we're going to take a look at the relationship between brain chemistry and toxic behavior. And then last but not least, sometimes toxic behavior is just the result of bad learning. So, for example, you may have a child who is inordinately aggressive because they grew up with aggressive or violent role models. So we'll take a look at that factor as well. So those are the three factors: dysfunctional family, atypical brain chemistry, and poor learning experiences. We'll look at each of those. And then the fourth and final objective is, how do you detox? How do you detoxify your life? I'm going to offer you very specific suggestions for taking better care of yourself so that you can be more resilient in the face of toxicity, because let's face it, sometimes we have to deal with toxic people and there's no way of avoiding it. If you work in a hospital or an agency setting, you have to work with every patient that's assigned to your caseload. You don't get to choose. I'm not going to work with her because she's too toxic. It doesn't play out that way. I'm not going to work with him because he has issues with anger. No, what you see is what you get. And so the question becomes, how can you take care of yourself so that you don't end up getting toxic yourself? So we'll talk about those strategies. How does that sound in terms of your expectations today, in terms of the goals for today's program? Okay, that's good. That's also a relief, because that's what I came prepared to talk about today, okay? We know that people who have certain forms of mental illness can have major problems with anger management. How many of you in here know somebody who has bipolar disorder? Now, the vast majority of people who have bipolar disorder, which used to be called manic depressive illness, they manage their symptoms very, very responsibly and very well. Most of them take medication, they've been involved in therapy, they've learned how to manage stress. These days, we encourage them to make changes in their diet. We know a lot more about bipolar disorder now than we did even 3 years ago. And so the vast majority of folks who get treatment for this do quite well. Every so often, though, you're going to have a bipolar patient who's non-compliant with treatment. Most specifically, they go off their medication, their mood-stabilizing medication. Inevitably, they become hypomanic or manic. They start to experience dysphoric hypomanic or manic symptoms, meaning unpleasant symptoms. They can't sleep. They have racing thoughts. They don't have much of an appetite. And they start to have lots of problems with managing aggression and other impulses. And they're very likely to act out in an aggressive way. In fact, if you look at forensic research, next to the psychopath, particularly the psychopathic serial killer, the bipolar 1 patient who has full-blown manic episodes and who's not compliant with medication is potentially the most dangerous person on the planet. When they go off their meds, they become highly aggressive, even violent, even homicidal, and they are most likely to attack and kill their relatives, the people that are closest to them. Very high rate of homicide. They also have the highest rate of completed suicide of any psychiatric diagnosis, which of course is violence turned inwards. That's the bipolar 1 patient. So there are some individuals who, because of their mental illness, have issues with aggression and violence, most especially if they're non-compliant with treatment. The others that are listed there, I think, are pretty self-explanatory. The one last point that I make there is that there are some people who engage in aggression because of religious or political fanaticism. It's called terrorism. And if you need examples of that, look no further than any television program, particularly news program. Look to any newspaper, look to any major news magazine, and sadly, you'll see many examples of that. So that's really the first main problem, first big problem that you're going to see with these people, anger management issues.